Thank you, members. I call Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My comments during First Minister's questions were over the line, and I would like to withdraw them and apologise to both the Chamber and the First Minister. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm grateful that Ms. White has reflected on her behaviour and that you have apologised to the Chamber for these remarks. You will be in no doubt at all, Ms. White, that great offence was caused, and I would like to be absolutely certain that that is an unambiguous apology, that you withdraw the remarks and that you apologise wholeheartedly. Can you please stand and confirm that that is indeed the case?
I confirm, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I would just like to say further that the fact that on this occasion no further action will be taken does not in any way detract from the seriousness with which I view this incident. Members must be in no doubt at all that I expect that their conduct at all times will be worthy of that of a member of the Scottish Parliament. Thank you.
Okay, can I remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and around the Holyrood campus. I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including while entering and exiting the Chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat or when moving around the Chamber. The next item of business is portfolio questions. The portfolio is Rural Affairs and Islands. If members want to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or press R in the chat function if they're joining us remotely during the course of the relevant question. And I call question number one, Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what monitoring it has undertaken of island economies following the easing of COVID-19 restrictions.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
We have been monitoring economic conditions across Scotland throughout the pandemic and will continue to do so as and when restrictions ease. Our new 10-year National Strategy for Economic Transformation will set out the steps we will take to deliver a green economic recovery and support new green jobs, businesses and industries for the future for all of Scotland.
Mr. Hawker-Johnson.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? Recovery from the COVID restrictions across island communities has been mixed, and some islands have been able to benefit from the process of opening up, while others, such as some of those affected by the summer ferry crisis, have not. I raised this issue with the Cabinet Secretary yesterday and didn't get an answer. So can I ask her what, in her role in cross-government coordination of islands policy, she has done to address the ongoing issues? And will she support the Transport Secretary coming to this chamber to make a statement as a matter of urgency?
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, in relation to the particular points that the member raises, and as he did raise yesterday in the debate, I hope that he has also raised these with the Minister for Transport, Graham Day, in relation to ferries. Now, we absolutely realise how critical and these are lifeline services, and that's why the Minister for Transport has made looking and addressing these issues his absolute priority. So I hope that the member will raise this with the relevant minister.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary, Alistair Allan.
Thank you. Will the Cabinet Secretary agree that coming out of a pandemic is the worst possible moment for many island businesses then to have to cope with staff shortages caused by the Brexit deal? And will she agree with many such island businesses that emergency COVID work visas for EU citizens would at least alleviate some of the mess which Brexit has created for them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely. Scotland has to be able to attract talented workers from across Europe without excessive immigration barriers. And under the new points-based system, the main visa routes are for high earners with almost no route at all for those below that threshold who are so desperately needed right across a number of different sectors. And that, along with the UK Government's decision to delay the implementation of the majority of the regulated qualifications framework 3 to 5 roles, and those eligible for the shortage occupation list really risks continued labour shortages, and especially in areas like our islands. The scale of the situation that faces island businesses is a direct consequence of the UK Government's approach to Brexit and its refusal to listen to the repeated warnings of the Scottish Government and sector stakeholders. Now, just last week and again this week, we've seen calls from across the food and drink industry, as well as the NFUS, calling for urgent action to address these problems, which I've also followed up on in my own correspondence to the UK Government. This is a crisis situation of their making through the reckless Brexit they pursued, and they now need to fix it.
Question number two, Maurice Golden.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it will take to support more sustainable farming.
Cabinet Secretary.
The economic and environmental sustainability of Scottish agriculture is absolutely paramount. I recently announced the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board and a consultation building on the recommendations from the farmer-led groups. In order to deliver early action on implementing measures, the Board will develop a preliminary package of funded measures for agreement by COP26, and that will be based on the work of the farmer-led groups with an early focus on livestock emissions. And I look forward to working together on this vital change programme to give farming and food production the long-term sustainable future that we're all committed to delivering.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Fibre production for the textiles industry, such as nettles, offers farmers an opportunity to support a sustainable supply chain while strengthening their own businesses. Will the Cabinet Secretary look at supporting the development of regional textile brands based on sustainability credentials to incentivise that fibre production?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for raising that point. And if he has a particular, if he's been approached in particular on this issue, then I'd be more than happy to meet with people that are taking this forward and to see what we can do to develop and support that. Because I think as we look to be more sustainable and create a circular economy, I think all these sorts of initiatives are absolutely vital. So if the member wants to contact me about that, I'd be more than happy to look into it.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. One of the many areas that I'm particularly proud of in the Green Scottish Government agreement are the targets to expand organic food and farming, which will restore the environment and support rural economies. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, does she see these targets as helping to drive the demand for organic food in our schools and other public kitchens? And does that provide perhaps then more certainty to farmers that they can convert to organic food and farming, knowing that there's a stable market there?
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, absolutely. And that's why we committed in our manifesto and in our recent cooperation agreement to at least doubling the amount of land farmed organically by the end of this parliamentary session. Because previously we have seen the amount of land that's been farmed organically going in the wrong direction to where it needs to go. That's why I'm absolutely committed to working with the sector to see what we can do to improve that. But the member also rightly raises some really important initiatives that are making a huge difference, such as the Food for Life scheme, which is run for a number of years and a number of local authorities are part of, and we really want to see what we can do to harness the public procurement power that we have in the public sector to really encourage the Food for Life scheme to see that expand into these other areas and encourage organic production, because we can see from the Food for Life programme the many benefits that have come from that. It improves our health, it improves our local economies, so we really want to see how we can develop and build on that.
Thank you. Question number three, Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on any progress that has been made on the use of mobile abattoirs.
Cabinet Secretary.
The feasibility study, which was commissioned by the Scottish Government and published in March last year, provides details of what would be required to operate mobile abattoirs in Scotland, including the regulatory framework, and it offers a cost-benefit analysis of possible operational models. However, the report also highlights the difficulty in achieving a sustained economic return from a mobile abattoir in Scotland. Any next steps would be for a commercial operator who wishes to take this forward, and the Scottish Government, in conjunction with Food Standards Scotland, would of course be willing to discuss in more detail with any organisation who are considering operating mobile abattoirs in Scotland.
Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Deputy Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. In recent evidence to the UK Parliament, the DEFRA Select Committee, the DEFRA Minister Lord Bennion committed the UK Government to supporting new initiatives such as mobile abattoirs to help support local demand. In the very report that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, recognition was made that there are areas of Scotland where animals have to be moved over 100 miles before they reach an abattoir. Given the NFU Scotland highlighted as far back as January 2019 that there is a steady and worrying loss of small abattoirs over the last few years, when will the Scottish Government match the UK Government's commitment, and when will it happen?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I outlined in my opening response there, that's why we want to undertake a study into that to see if this would be feasible. And that's why we've committed to working with any operators who would be keen to take this forward and to see if this could be something that we could make work in Scotland. I absolutely understand the point that the member has raised. Ideally, we want to see food processed as close to the point of primary production as possible, and we're keen to work with anyone who's willing to take that forward.
Got a couple of supplementaries. I hope the questions and answers are both brief. Firstly, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary what support the Scottish Government is providing to Scotland's quality pig producer sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I was really pleased to have announced this week on Monday that we opened the Scottish Government's Pig Producers Hardship Support Scheme for applications, and that scheme will provide up to £715,000 of financial support to pig producers who were affected by the temporary closure of the abattoir in Brechin earlier this year. Now, we've worked closely with the sector to make sure that that fund provides affected farmers with financial support for the losses incurred that was through no fault of their own, and the scheme is open for applications until the 26th of September, so I would really encourage people to make their applications as soon as possible.
And Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We on these benches agree that mobile abattoirs are important. However, the SNP Government must support livestock farming to ensure its sustainability. So will the Cabinet Secretary confirm or deny that her civil servants suggested that Scottish livestock farmers should slaughter thousands of cattle, and tell the Chamber why the Suckler Beef Climate Change Group has been ignored since March?
Cabinet Secretary.
As the member will know, because I refuted that statement yesterday during the food and drink industry debate that we had, I said it was nonsense then, and it's still nonsense today.
Question number four, Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the future of farm support payments.
Cabinet Secretary.
On the 25th of August, as one of our 100 days commitments, I announced the establishment of the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board, which will contribute to the Scottish Government's work to implement policy reform, incorporating the relevant recommendations of the farmer-led groups to cut emissions across agriculture, support the production of sustainable, high-quality food, and design a new support system and approach. A national test programme will include early progress on reducing livestock emissions, and the package should be implemented by spring 2022, with recruitment of farmers and crofters expected to begin this autumn.
Stephen Kerr.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her reply, but farmers have little certainty about future payments, and the Scottish Government has been called out by Chris Stark, the CEO of the Committee on Climate Change, about the overdue national agriculture policy. Does the Cabinet Secretary really think that new committees to replace old committees and another consultation document are the answer? More deliberation, more dilly-dallying is a disaster for the sector. Why won't this government make decisions now?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we think it's vitally important to include the people who these decisions will affect in our decision-making. I said that this is an implementation and oversight board. I will be co-chairing that with the President of NFUS Scotland, Martin Kennedy, exactly to drive forward the work of the farmer-led groups, which was a manifesto commitment of ours, and that's what we've committed to, and that's exactly what this board will deliver. That's why I've set out the actions that I have today, because we want this board to get to work and to deliver.
Okay, we covered a lot of this ground in the debate yesterday, but I'm keen to take the two supplementaries. First, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the long overdue establishment of the Implementation Board and the proposals from the farmer-led groups. I hope they'll implement, but given the government's dithering over the last few years and the fact that the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary, has just said a lot of those proposals won't be introduced until 2022, is she absolutely confident that we will meet our targets for reductions in emissions in agriculture that are set out in the Climate Change Plan over the next few years?
Cabinet Secretary.
I will, of course, be doing everything within my power to make sure that happens. And that's not to say that a lot of the measures would be delivered next year. That's a specific piece of work which we tried to set out a timeline for. But again, I want to see the Implementation Oversight Board get to work in delivering early on the recommendations of the farmer-led groups. And I think it's only right that we involve farmers, crofters, land managers in that discussion as we move forward and as we look to establish a new payment scheme for post-2024. Because it's also important to remember that we have set out stability and simplicity to ensure that farmers could rely on the payments and knew what was coming over the course of the next few years. But we also know that we need to get going when it looks to tackling our emissions reductions. I know that the sector are keen to get going, and I absolutely want to work with them on that.
And briefly, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just like to ask the Cabinet Secretary, how does she feel that the policy that she will be developing will differ from that of the UK Government?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think probably the first point that I'd like to make in relation to that is to point out that the UK Government spending review overall provides insufficient budget to replace EU funding levels lost to Scotland. There's still little clarity on the replacement of EU programmes, and particularly on structural funds, and we only get a single-year guarantee compared to the seven-year EU budget guarantee. So, and there are also key concerns about the Internal Market Bill, which, of course, represents a clear assault on devolved spending powers. Now, between now and 2024-25, Scotland will lose out on up to £170 million of funding, and the current one-year settlement doesn't provide the assurances that we need. Now, DEFRA has announced a move away from direct payments and supporting food production to a focus on what they call public goods, and that's certainly not the direction that we're intending to take.
Thank you. Question number five, Pam Gothel.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to support the new entrants into the agriculture sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, reports such as Farming for 1.5 underline the stark challenges facing Scottish agriculture. They also highlight the continuing role for skilled and innovative young new entrant farmers and crofters. Now, we agree with that view and so continue to support new entrants through a number of measures, including the Farming Opportunities for New Entrants programme and the Land Matching Service, which we fund NFUS to deliver. The National Reserve can also provide new farmers and crofters with an allocation of payment entitlements under the Basic Payment Scheme, as well as the Young Farmers Basic Payment Top-Up. In line with our own manifesto commitment, I will also announce how we intend to support new and young entrants through a specific fund during this parliamentary term.
Pam Gosol.
Thank you. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. The importance of new entrants and young farmers cannot be overstated, nor can the importance of attracting applicants from all walks of life. With that in mind, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what actions the Scottish Government is taking to support BAME applicants into the agriculture sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises a vitally important point, and I think it's absolutely right that we try and encourage diversity where possible. And I'd be more than happy to meet with the member to discuss actions that we can take in that regard.
Thank you. And a brief supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Thank you. What is the Scottish Government doing to encourage more young people to get the skills and education needed to become farmers, crofters and take up other land-based career opportunities in the Highlands and Islands in order to tackle depopulation?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government recently announced the establishment of a commission for land-based learning, and this was also part of our 100-day commitments. And what we intend with that review is that it will consider the learning pipeline from early years to adults with a view to increasing opportunities for more people, and particularly more women, to gain qualifications and employment in the land-based and aquaculture sectors. Agriculture is one of the key sectors which is included in that review, and the review will support the Scottish Government's ambitions of delivering a just transition to net zero and a climate-resilient Scotland by ensuring that our learning system equips people with the skills and knowledge needed to work in Scotland's land-based and aquaculture sectors.
Question number six, Joe Fitzpatrick, who joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with the UK Government regarding the UK seasonal worker scheme.
Cabinet Secretary.
Food production is critical to the success of our economy, and the edible horticulture sector has to be equipped with the necessary tools in order to continue to flourish. Unfortunately, the seasonal workers scheme is not working for employers or for seasonal workers. Scottish ministers have listened to the sector, and on the 16th of March, the Minister for Rural Affairs and Minister for Europe and International Development wrote to the UK Immigration Minister, urging him to make the necessary improvements to the route to make it fit for purpose. Now, despite migration impacting on devolved areas, the UK Immigration Minister has refused to recognise the interests of this Parliament and the role of the Scottish Government, failing to respond positively to 19 requests for meetings from the Scottish Government Minister with responsibility for migration. And I've also written to the UK Government this week to highlight the impacts of existing labour and skills shortages on the food and drink industry. I await a response to that.
Jo Fitzpatrick.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Over the past week, I've met with Dundee Cold Stores and Highland Game in my constituency, both crucial businesses in the food supply chain who rely upon being able to access sufficient labour, especially during the peak season. Food and Drink Federation Scotland warn that they are now rapidly approaching a crisis, and NFU Scotland are calling for an improved permanent seasonal worker scheme. Can the Cabinet Secretary offer an assurance that the Scottish Government will continue to make representations UK Government to ensure that both agriculture and the wider food and drink supply chain are able to recruit and retain the necessary staff, as well as access haulage to get their products to market, both of which these sectors depend on? And can I ask the Cabinet Secretary...
Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary.
Again, the member highlights an absolutely critical issue here, and as he referenced in his question there, members will have all seen the letter that was sent from the food and drink industry to both the UK and Scottish governments last week, highlighting the crisis situation that they now face in terms of labour. Now, I've responded to the industry in terms of our asks, and of course we'll continue to work with them to assist in any way that we can. And again, as I've just highlighted, I've also written to the UK government this week to highlight the impact of existing labour and skills shortages on the food and drink industry. We also wrote to the UK Government in July to push for changes to UK migration policies and to highlight the impact of licensing delays for the HGV sector. Now, Scottish ministers will continue to discuss these issues in our ongoing engagement with the UK Government and other devolved governments, and we will continue to press for urgent action.
Okay. Question number 7, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its engagement with the seafood sector regarding any export challenges as a result of Brexit.
Cabinet Secretary.
We have engaged regularly with the sector to mitigate the impacts of EU exit on seafood exports and its associated challenges. For instance, the Food Sector Resilience Group have met regularly to address the ongoing challenges EU exit has caused the Scottish seafood sector. And in addition to that, the Scottish Seafood Exports Task Force, which included UK government representation, met regularly between February and July this year and published its final report on the 26th of August. Over the summer, I've also met seafood businesses firsthand, visiting fish farms, fish markets, and processing businesses to hear directly from those working in the industry. And my officials have been in regular contact with a range of industry representatives about specific issues, such as the introduction of new export health certificates, and to explore medium, longer-term recommendations about how best to support the sector.
Karen Adam.
Over recess, I visited Peterhead Producers Market and spoke with seafood industry leaders who are working hard to future-proof the industry from the unmitigated disaster inflicted by a damaging UK government Brexit. Whilst the UK government has clearly sold out Scotland's fishing communities, can the Cabinet Secretary outline what steps the Scottish Government is taking to mitigate the damage and to support seafood businesses to diversify in the face of these Brexit challenges?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Our local food strategy consultation and the development of a sustainably Scottish brand will both support and grow Scottish seafood as a sustainable low-carbon food. And along with our work on a new seafood trade strategy, we've awarded £1.8 million to Seafood Scotland to revitalise the domestic market and help to develop new global markets. And we've also provided over £800,000 for seafood businesses, including for storage facilities at a major seafood processor and for seafood businesses in the North East, to develop seafood processing and training. And in addition to that, £5.2 million was awarded to Peterhead Port Authority for harbour and market improvements.
Very briefly, Beatrice Wishart.
The seafood and other sectors in the Northern Isles have been battling Brexit disruption along with ferry freight capacity limitations. How does the Scottish Government plan to mitigate the twin challenges of Brexit and ferry freight capacity on the Lifeline services to ensure produce can get to market on time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, I hope I've been able to at least address the first part of the member's question in some of the responses that I've given today. We're working tirelessly with the industry to try and mitigate and do what we can to tackle the impacts of Brexit. But unfortunately, a lot of the levers for that are simply out with our control. And when it comes to the freight issue, again, I would urge the member to raise this with the Minister for Transport, who I know has been dealing and looking at these issues.
And question 8, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government how it will protect the interests of farmers under the draft cooperation agreement with the Scottish Green Party.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government and others across this chamber and across the country believe Scotland should be a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture. Now, we will ensure we continue to support the sector to produce high-quality food while we take action to make the emission reductions required to contribute to Scotland's world-leading emissions targets to support and deliver nature restoration and a just transition to net zero. I outline my approach to have farmers, crofters and land managers at the heart of developing new policy, which is why I launched the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board last week.
Very briefly, Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but does she understand the fear of farmers in my constituency that the Scottish Government now has members within it who've previously advocated a drastic reduction in livestock production and talked up the prospect of covering 40% of Scotland in forestry?
Cabinet Secretary.
Again, we had similar points raised during the food and drink debate yesterday, and I would ask the member if he's actually read the cooperation agreement, where we've outlined our approach. And again, I've established the board to ensure that we can deliver the recommendations of the farmer-led groups and make sure we have a sustainable future for Scottish farming.
Thank you very much.